Make that big boss less special. It ain't no game, but they saying welcome to the second level.
So this is the, what panel are we on? I forgot already. This is the, like the, yeah, what it's like to indie. So we're gonna talk about being an independent game studio here in the STL and just in general, because this would be applicable to anybody, anywhere. My name is Adron Buskey. I am the host of the Nerd for a Living podcast, which is a podcast that explores the lives and careers of people who work in genre entertainment. And so that encompasses film and TV and comics and fiction and video game making. I am also part of the planning committee of Pixel Pop Festival, which is a local gaming festival going on its fourth year. And this year it's going to be at the St. Louis University Bush Student Center on August 5th and 6th. So if you like games and you like making games or are interested in making games, you should definitely go. It's an all ages event. It's going to be really awesome and super fun. And we can talk about it afterwards. And I had a whole brick of cards to give out, but it's in my car in traffic with my wife somewhere right now. So you'll have to take my word for them. They're really pretty cards. When it comes to gaming stuff, the only cred that I have is that I actually used to make flash games for advertising for companies while I worked in radio back in the day. None of them were very exciting, so I'm not going to go into them. But I also did the audio production on a game called Sleepy Kraken for Volcano Bean, which happens to be Mary's company. And otherwise, I'm just a podcaster. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down the line here, starting with Sam, and just have these guys introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about the studio they work with.
Hey, I'm Sam. I'm from Butterscotch Shenanigans. I'm one of the co-founders and lead artist over at the studio. And our most recent title is called Crashlands. It came out in January 2016 on mobile and on PC both. And our goal is to basically establish our studio as an IP powerhouse with cross-platform games that you can play on Steam and then port the save over to your mobile device and take it with you on the road so you can never escape from the games we have.
Nice. Hi, I'm Mary McKenzie. I run Volcano Bean, a three-person indie studio located out of St. Louis. We have two free mobile games, Sleepy Kraken and Where's My Goblin, that are free on iOS and Google Play. And we're currently working on our first big kid game, Battle Cakes, a snack-sized RPG that'll be out on console, PC, and mobile next year.
Did you call it a big kid game?
I did. It is our first big kid game.
I love it. Yeah.
And I'm Ben Cook. I'm about 95% of Well-Bred Rhino. I had a game that came out a long time ago called All the Bad Parts, and my next one, Last Ditch Goodnight, is coming out on Steam and PS4 in exactly 1 month from today.
Woo! So,
look for it.
Fun. Awesome. So the first thing I want to get into is, what is your guys' like background in like education and careers leading up to going into games? Is this something that like you came out the gate like, you know, you were born and like, I will make games? just like that when you were like 1 year old, what led to this part of your career and what is that educational background? We can start back here with that.
So I got a degree in psychology and I just played games a lot, but I never thought that I'd be able to make them because this is back in 2008. And so Unity and a bunch of the engines that were made game development a lot easier were still just starting to kind of get their legs under them. And if you didn't have a really, really intense programming background, it was generally really hard to consider kind of breaking into the field. So I just, this will be a good pastime for the rest of my life, but not something I ever get to do, whatever. I'll get a degree in psychology. And did that, and then ended up making a game at a game jam here in St. Louis in 2010, in 2 days, using Game Maker Studio, which is actually the engine that we use for all of our stuff currently. It's a 2D game making engine that takes away all the sort of nonsense of memory handling and the non-fun parts of making things explode on a screen. And after those 2 days, I basically sat back from the computer and I was like, wait a second, I just made a game. And it was absolutely terrible, but I made one. And so I was like, maybe I could do this. And I still just kept on going with the degree. Ended up graduating, wrote my brother in. He'd always wanted to make games. He's kind of the actual sort of video game driving force in our studio. He's all about it. Whereas I think the rest of us are just really have a fun time doing problem solving stuff and generally approaching the games industry, which is a really weird, hard place to make a living, as there's a really interesting set of complicated problems that we all get to solve. And I do art, but I didn't have any training in it. I did not wake up as a 3-year-old or something and, you know, with a crayon in my hand, scribbling on the walls all the time. It literally started 4.5 years ago when we started the studio, and that's been that. So that's been a big, crazy journey as well.
Yeah, kind of similar. I did not grow up wanting to make games. I love games. I played them my whole life. But shockingly, they were not pushing 10-year-old girls towards programming like back in 1990. But I have a fine arts degree, so I went into costuming and illustration. After college, I was a freelance artist for a long time. But I always just loved making things. And so I kept just finding different routes for making different products. And I guess it was 2.5 years ago, my husband and I had already had a company with past endeavors. It was very wibbly wobbly path. But we decided we had published this coloring book that we were selling at craft shows. And I was like, I really want this to be an iPad app. That's kind of a big thing. So let's make a very small, like, bite-sized app, see if we even like the process. Let's go from start to published. And that was Where's My Goblin? And we really fell in love with the process and then, like, started to realize all of the different things that we could actually do and how much more accessible it had become in the years. Because even, like, 5-10 years ago, like, it wasn't. Yeah. If you didn't have a strong programming background, like, it wasn't really something that you were going to do. So, yeah, that's kind of where we started, was just a, like, hey, let's figure this out. And now we're here.
Back in the 80s, the late 80s, I had a Mac Plus, and my sister got something called World Builder that you could use to make games, and I was not supposed to use it because it was hers. She was given it as a gift. So I really wanted to play with it. So I ended up making a bunch of games in World Builder on a Mac Plus that no human could even see. Like, it just doesn't even exist anymore. So that kind of lit the fire for me. And then, you know, a decade later, I think it was probably when Microsoft released their XNA initiative, which was really this effort of saying you can write code that's going to run on an Xbox 360. And for me, like, playing around making games was something I was doing just for fun, just messing around. But, like, the idea of getting it on a console was, like, just, you know, blinding insight for me. So that was kind of the gateway for me to really get into it. So I got to make my first game on 360. And then since then, just seeing what's happened with the Unity engine, like you mentioned, Game Maker, all that stuff, just all these doors opening, it's made it a lot more accessible. And it's been really exciting to watch it evolve over the last, you know, 20 years.
So as you guys, you know, you discover a love of gaming, you discover a love of making games. But at what point do you knuckle down and say, okay, I'm going to make a studio, or I'm going to set out on my own independently, versus going, okay, well, you know, maybe I want to go work at a AAA publisher, or you know, let somebody else handle, like, you know, the big business part of it, so that I can just go make stuff. You know, where was the decision-making process for you to say, no, we're going to do this on our own, independent, you know, solo and strong, and making our own choices and mistakes along the way?
I mean, I think at least for us, it was because I don't think anybody would take us at the time, honestly, because you know, I had no art background at all. So, and then Seth, my brother, who was the lead programmer for us, he had maybe a year of programming just inside Game Maker Studio. And he had taught himself how to code using drag and drop, like the code block stuff that they offer in there, before transitioning all the way into code. And so the idea of us being able to apply to anywhere and get an actual job with my, like, really terrible 2D art and his, you know, really hack job Game Maker programming is just, it just wasn't going to happen. So it was kind of this thing where I think, so we ended up getting hired from a game jam that we did, and got hired in the parking lot for a studio here in town, worked there for a few months, and that was only because they got to see what the games were that we make, but not all the hideous stuff that kind of went in underneath, you know? So they saw the finished product, which was good. We worked there for about 6 or 7 months, and then just decided that we wanted to try it, because we sort of, you know, we had sort of nestled money away in the bank, and then through working there, gained enough expertise and stuff that we were at least, you know, maybe arrogant enough to think that we could do it by ourselves. And I think that's kind of what kicked it off for us, at least. I don't know.
Yeah, kind of similar. Although, really, I have a corporate, like, my corporate background is more in product development. And so I kind of have seen the back end of when you're working for another company, it's not yours, it's the company's. And just, well, one, we did not have any game making experience. So going to a AAA and being like, hi, I want to make games, right, would not have gone well. And also, you need to build a portfolio, which is what Where's My Goblin was the very beginning of for us. But honestly, the more we make games, like, I really enjoy the process from start to finish. And once you start working for another company, like, you give up a lot of that ownership and a lot of that control. So yeah, that's really kind of where we have decided to stay. Like, it's a slower path. It's a less stable path, but you kind of hedge your bets in a lot of different ways and go from there.
Yeah, and I would agree with that, definitely. Yeah. For me, it was when I made the first 360 game, I was proud and just desperate for people to see it, right? So I'm sending it all these studios saying, like, hey, look at this thing I made. And a couple of them invited me out, and I got to go hang out with them for the day. And they're like, so if you were here, you know, what would you like to work on here that we're working on, blah, blah, blah. And my reaction every time was like, well, I kind of want to work on my stuff because I think it's really fun. So if you guys could bring me on and I could work on my stuff, that would be great. and they're like, okay. Which is a way to say okay of being like, that's not how an employee relationship works. Right. That's not what happens. Mm-hmm. So
we give you money and you just do whatever you want to do.
I just want to keep doing my thing, which is not what they
want
to do.
But I would like you to fund it.
Yes, exactly. So it was really kind of that moment of like, well, I kind of just want to keep working on my own thing. I kind of want to keep figuring out, you know, what a game is, what a game can be, you know, have fun drawing the art and making the story and writing the code. And I just enjoyed every part of it so much that the notion of just picking one to focus on was just not appealing to me.
So for your studios now, I know, Ben, you mentioned earlier that you're like 95% of your studio. So that answers my question of how many people are actually in
the other 5% is hand puppets. More explosions. I know. Right?
I feel like I've got this very deep insight into Ben's psyche all of a sudden.
We have a lot of arguments in my studio.
For the rest of you, like, I mean, you've met, like, you know, you've kind of mentioned it in passing, but like, how many people are in your studio, and what are the different roles that they fulfill explicitly? You know.
Yeah. So our studio originally was myself and my brother, so that was just art and programming. And then when the art ran out, then and Seth was still debugging and trying to make things go, then I would do marketing. And then we brought on my third brother, who does sort of statistics analysis and back-end web infrastructure for us. And then after CrashLands, we've hired four more people. So we have one artist, an administrative assistant, a tech and tools guy, and then a games programmer as well. So we kind of just doubled the overall capacity plus an administrative person.
So you didn't like go to your mom and dad and say, hey, could you just make us a couple more siblings?
Yeah.
Because we need some more people to do some work.
We don't talk about the fourth brother. Just kidding, there isn't one, but yeah.
Yeah, kind of similar, actually. My husband and I have always loved making projects together, and then one of his best friends from high school, they've always made art together, they did D&D together, they've always just done creative things together. And so it's just we, the three of us, kind of decided we wanted to make games together. So Matt Senior is who does all of our art, or is the lead artist, I should say. Gene Kelly, my husband, does like the programming, is the lead programmer. And then I run the studio, and I'm the producer and backup programmer / backup artist. All the other random things that get filled, and then we outsource all of our music to a local company called Fat Bard.
Which yeah,
I
believe we do too.
Both of these people do as well.
He's the go-to guy.
Yeah.
The lesson is, if you need music, you go to Fat Bard.
Yeah. Pretty much.
He's probably my other 5%, really, at the end of the day.
And
the same thing. I like to do everything in making games, but there's just a part of my brain that never developed for music. So I just can't even think in terms of making a musical composition. So yeah, I've been working with Fat Bard, and it's just been amazing. So
yeah, we actually did the music for Where's My Goblin, because my husband does have a background in music. He plays guitar and piano and bass. Cool. And we can do the music, but we realized like that is such a huge, like, big part of any game. Like, we didn't one that would just take even longer, and like there's other people who specialize it, and Fat Bard is super fast and just amazing. So we decided that was well worth our time and money too, or well worth their time and our money too.
Absolutely.
What's the average day kind of look like for you and your studios? I mean, I know that's kind of a tough thing to quantify, but like, you know, how do you
we're pretty regimented, actually. So we have, we're very orderly. We start at 8 a.m., we go till 4, and it's just basically 8 a.m., everybody kind of knows what they're going to do, and if not, then we do a quick sort of, I guess we have departments now, technically, if there's two people in one, you know, doing one thing. So the different pieces of the team will kind of break out and chat about what exactly they're going to try to accomplish during the week or during the day, and then it's just kind of off to the races. And we all have, so we actually work out of Seth's basement currently, and so we all just pile in there, and it's just this desk train. So there's six desks all piled together, and then a seventh one for our admin assistant Monique off in the corner, because we don't have much space. So we're like, we're at capacity. It gets warm. There's a lot of bodies. But yeah, so we all start working, and then we all have these sound canceling headphones. And so you'll say something like, I'm going in, and then you flip it on, and then you put it on, and everyone just ignores you, and you're like, it's like you're in your own sort of void of creative space. So it's weird, because it's punctuated by, you know, like lots of screaming and puns and jokes and music, and then periods like an hour and a half or two of just complete silence, aside from key taps, which is a little freaky. Like if you come in late and you just hear this sort of like thundering taps from downstairs. We all got mechanical keyboards, so it's like you just hear this rain from downstairs. But that's pretty much a standard day, I guess. just an 8 to 4, you know.
It sounds mildly creepy, but in a good way.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
I'll be creepy.
We're a little bit different because I'm actually the only full-time employee. Matt and Gene both have day jobs. So we have two set meetings every week. We meet Wednesday evening and Sunday morning, where we actually get into the same room so we can do a lot of our collaborative work. And then we'll have random like Skype sessions throughout the week as we need. But yeah, we do a lot of Slack. We do a lot of group text because there's only three of us. It's pretty easy to do. And yeah, so Gene and Matt work, like they try to fit in as much work as they can like during the day, but they also just work at night. And then I kind of work during the day, but also at night because we all have small children. That's the other caveat. Yeah. So like we have kids and so we also have to fit in day jobs and children and our regular life on top of also making games, which we love to do, otherwise we wouldn't do it. So. Yeah, ours is a not new. I would love for it to be a structure to Sam's, right. But it's, yeah, we have to do a little bit more, like, where can we actually find the time? But we have carved out specifically, like, Wednesday and Sunday. Those are our days, and eventually we'll make 3 days. And, like, as we keep getting into development, we will carve out more and more time.
Right. But at what point do you start training the children to pick up the slack?
Yeah. Actually, my oldest is already, like, wants to be on in the meeting so bad. She's almost 8. She does little animations on, like, the Goldie Blocks app, and, oh, like, cool. She's, like, she wants to be part of Volcano Beans so bad. So I'm like, yeah, learn animation.
Instead of making them go mow the lawn, you make them do like between frames.
Yeah. I mean, she could make her own game and pay for college. Like,
yeah. Yeah.
These are my life plans.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah. And my oldest does some of the voices for me when I need word voices.
We can make a child studio.
Yes, that's it. And then we just get to kick back. We don't have to do anything at that point.
Exactly, perfect plan.
This is the retirement plan for everybody.
It's a good plan. It's a good plan.
Nice.
So for me, I'm kind of ridiculous in that I kind of realized that I'm way more effective in the morning. Like as the day goes on, my brain just stops working as good. And then when I like, if I try to stop at like 5 o'clock and I'm right in the middle of a big problem, that big problem is going to haunt me all the way till the next day. Like I just cannot get it out of my brain the rest of the day. So I get up around like 5 or 6 usually and start working then. And just kind of focus on that. And then in terms of figuring out what to work on as kind of the solo dev of the studio, I keep a pretty good backlog of tasks I need to do. And then I just try to, you know, whatever's on the top of the list, that's what I start working on that day. I work on that until I hit a complete roadblock. And then the big thing I do is if I hit a roadblock and I don't feel comfortable getting around that roadblock, I just drop that for the day. I move on to the next one and I make progress there. So that way I'm never really, you know, dead in the water. And plus usually by like the next day or maybe 3 days later, my brain has had time to kind of process everything that's going on. And I've got some ideas of how I could tackle that problem again. So a big goal for me is just waste zero time. Just keep making progress on whatever that needs to be done. And when you're making games, there's just so much that needs to be done. You never run out of things to do. So if you just keep jumping from stuff to stuff while keeping a list of goals, you can get them all done and not waste any time.
So you talked about there, like, you know, there's always things to do, which I imagine also means that there's a lot of times where you run into problems or like issues that you haven't encountered before, something you have to, you know, troubleshoot for, or just skill sets maybe you don't have necessarily. So how do you handle the situations? Like now you've got like a bigger crew, you guys have like a smaller team, you know, handling it. So when you run into that moment where you're like, oh, I don't have somebody who fills this specific position, or I don't know how to handle this issue, like how do you guys tackle that?
The internet.
Yeah.
See,
I lay on a couch and just stare at the ceiling until I can get over the existential crisis.
Yeah, I mean, you routinely, and I'm sure this happens to you guys, but it's pretty much every day, you come across something, you're like, I have no idea what this is. I don't know what this is about. Just every single day. So it actually becomes, it's part of the skill set, actually, is just confronting your lack of knowledge in everything, because you have to do everything to make games, and then Googling. Essentially.
Yep. Basically, you realize you know nothing.
Yeah.
And the minute you start to feel like you're getting a little bit ahead, and you're like, yeah, I've got this, you like turn a corner, and you realize how little you know, even more. So that's the cycle that happens.
Absolutely.
Making games is embracing the ignorance. That's all. Just really, when I saw the name of the panel too, right? And like, to me, I was thinking, you know, what does indie mean? And to me, it's not having someone else you can pull in when something just gets too much for you. You know, it's you are the person who has to shoulder this entire burden, and, you know, not being scared off by that, but kind of embracing it and saying that I know that's something I have to do, and that's just something I'm going to do because no one else is going to do it for me.
Yeah.
Right. If somebody came to you right now and handed you like $60,000 to throw into your budget for the year so you could hire somebody, what would be that position? What thing is missing right now that would make your life a lot easier, at least, you know, that you could imagine?
Well, I think we finally got our, like, we just finished hiring these two people like 2 months ago. And so like we just finally got our actual sort of, you know, version 2.0 of the studio set and ready to rock. But as far as like just extra capacity and extra power, I think having another games programmer around is always good because we have a back catalog now of 5 games. And so the problem is you run into this issue where it's like, do I continue to work on the new game, or do I go back and handle the fact that iOS just updated and all my stuff's going to break next week? And so we were playing that game for a long time, and our new programmer's been handling that, but we don't yet have extra actual game-making capacity besides just the one lead programmer. So I think that would probably be a really good spot for us.
For us, honestly, I would want to split it 50-50 between admin and extra programming, because I can handle some of the overflow programming. But it would be nice to have someone with a little more experience, like specifically with the problems we're starting to deal with. But really, admin, like the day-to-day, like people don't think about, like, you are making games, but you also have to run a business. And you have to, like, talk to the different reps and the different platforms that you're on. And you have to make sure that you have your bookkeeping up to date and you have your taxes filed and you have the really unsexy, unfun things taken care of to actually publish those games at the end of the day. And you can seek out a publisher who will handle a lot of that for you. But they also take a sizable chunk of your money in the end. So it's that game. So yeah, at this moment in time in our studio's history, I would probably want to get another admin person first and or programmer. Split. Yeah. That's my answer. Yeah,
for me, probably music and sound effects are a big chunk of it. And also, yeah, just marketing. Like, because that's the one thing that you have to do just daily. You just have to keep, you know, informing people of who you are, what you're doing, why it's useful, why it's important, why it's interesting. And, you know, just having the ability to give that to someone else would be nice. Because I'd rather make games.
Yeah. So you guys mentioned earlier, like, you know, you turn to the internet, you go to, you know, to answer questions and stuff like that. What are the resources that you guys turn to, like, most consistently to evolve your skills, to answer questions for you? Is there specific forums, websites, online communities that help you out? What are they?
We tend to just do a run-through of Gamma Sutra, our games industry, every couple days, just to see if there's anything new that's popped up.
It's interesting, but we have to go.
Oh, no. Yeah, no worries.
Thank you.
But yeah, so we usually stop in on both of those just to see, you know, what's going on. And every so often someone publishes a really interesting piece that you can sort of elevate my favorite ones are the marketing ones actually, where they're like, here's how you do it, bullet, bullet, bullet. And I'm like, great, I'm just going to take that. Move on. You don't have to think about this.
Yeah.
So those are the two that we use quite a bit.
Yeah, I would say same. Also, we specifically work in Unity, so the Unity documentation actually is huge for me and for us. Also, YouTube, but that's specifically Unity. There's a ton of people who are really passionate about that platform, or engine, I should say. So there's a lot of people who have solved a lot of the problems already. You just kind of have to see what they're doing. But also just, documentation. Yeah. And really the biggest trick, though, is learning to ask the right questions. Mm-hmm. I think it's really, honestly, almost doesn't matter where you're looking, you need to know what to ask first.
How to Google?
Yes. Yeah.
And for me, I think probably just even, you know, a little bit of networking. There's, like we talked about before, the door has been busted open for making indie games, which is fantastic. But then there's so many options of what engine to use, what tools to use. So for me, you know, just having some people around me also trying to do indie development and figuring out, you know, what tools are they using that they enjoy. And that's incredibly helpful to say, you know, oh, I didn't even realize sound was such a big problem for me. But now here's this, you know, fantastic library that I can get from the Unity store for $15 that's going to solve all these problems for me. And, you know, just like as indie developers, one of our big goals is making people aware of our games. All these tools, you know, their big goal is making us aware of their tools so that we can make games even better. So just being involved in the community, talking to people, seeing what they like using has been incredibly helpful.
And it's also part of the community. Like St. Louis actually has, we didn't realize when we shipped our first game, but has a great, amazing community, the STL Game Dev Co-op. I think it's stlgamedev.com. But just being part of that community and having other people you can ask a random question to, like, I know I've reached out to Ben and been like, we're running into this issue. Have you ever seen it? That is also really helpful. So like, there's a ton of stuff online, but also like that person-to-person like community is also super helpful. Yeah.
So stepping aside from the actual making of games, but thinking about the studio in general, you have to develop a brand, a name, an identity, a voice for your specific studio and the stuff that you put out. Did that stuff happen for you guys organically? I mean, like, at what point do you say, we want to have a studio name with as many syllables in it as possible that people will have a hard time spelling? You know, like, I mean, how do those identities come into play? And then how do you kind of figure out how you use those to speak and to market who you are?
Well, I think the nice thing about being an indie studio is it's because it's going to be an extension of yourself, basically, no matter what you do, when it's just three or four people or even one. So it's like you can't it's kind of hard to manufacture it. I think it's going to come out of you no matter what. And so ours was very, very organic. And you can actually see, if you look at some of our YouTube videos from the past, you can see the title screen evolve over time. And the name set, it used to be Butter and then Scotch. Like I said, it was a three-word thing. Butter, Scotch, Shenanigans. It's three different pieces. And then eventually we had a logo early on, and then we realized that the word itself, the name itself, was goofy and weird and a lot of syllables and sort of grabbed attention. So we just started using that. So all the language we use to describe everything is basically, it's just us writing. And so it's only become, now that we've grown a little bit, that we've had to sort of sit down and actually codify for our new people. If a new person comes into the studio and says, "Hello, I'll write this newsletter for you," or if you hire a contractor, There's actually a ton of effort you have to go into to explain something you didn't realize you had accidentally developed, at least in our case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't even notice it. So
I would say the same, like, because we've all, myself, Gene, and Matt have all known each other for so long, we just have a voice. Right. Like, And we all have a very similar aesthetic, and like it's not something that we tried to do. I guess eventually you have to figure out how you want to communicate that effectively and communicate to other people if you are going to have them work for you. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's kind of something that I feel like if you try to manufacture, it would be really inauthentic, and like you would be able to tell. So you just kind of have to pay attention to what you're already doing. Like, where do you gravitate towards? Like, we are very like kind of all ages, whimsical style, and it, like, we're not going to suddenly start making like really gritty first person shooters.
Right.
Like, I don't know. So
yeah, and have fun with it and kind of convey that your studio is about having fun with making games.
Absolutely.
Yeah. For me, it was that exactly, and then trying to dial it back just a little bit. When I announced my release date, like, I sent the press all an email saying that you're invited to the Last Ditch Goodnight birthday party. And I think a few people didn't feel they fully understood what I meant by that. So it was my voice, but my voice is confusing. So a big goal for me has been, you know, keeping that personality, but realizing, like, when you're contacting press, when you're sending out a press release, a lot of times what Sites wants to do is, you know, take what you've sent them, copy it, paste it, and then tweak it a little bit to add their voice to it. Because they get so many of these every day, which makes sense to them. You know, that is a very good approach for them. So, you know, trying to find a way to not put so much of myself in it that if someone were to look at it, they would say, "I can't put this on my website. This makes zero sense whatsoever. Where is the party at and is there cake?" So I try to find a way to have a voice, but then tone it down a wee bit.
I would like to go on record that I backed your Kickstarter and I expect cake.
There will be cake.
Okay, good. Actually, I prefer pie, but, you know, still.
There will be cake.
So with the methodology that each of you guys have, the core little group, what do you think is, like, the biggest advantage that you have as a small studio, as independents, and the way that you work? Like, is there something that, like, you feel like, I don't know, every day you sit and, like, oh, man, we really kill it because of X. Like, this thing really works for us.
My husband is great. No, I'll help you out there. Hi, Gene.
I mean, he is. My husband is fantastic. But no, I think for us right now, we're still fairly small and not like we're slowly growing a fan base. But we can, because we're small and we're only three people, we don't have a lot of expectations on us. So we get to do whatever we want right now. So I guess that is our biggest thing, is that we really like, even when we started making games and I wanted to, like, we realized we really loved it and we wanted to make more, I was like, let's really take the time and, like, figure out what, like, where we want to go with this and not just try to, like, shoehorn in something that doesn't fit just because it's, like, theoretically going to sell or, like, that's what's selling on the App Store. So, yeah, that's something that we've really done, is tried to take our time figuring out our style, figuring out what we really want to do, what's our voice, and that happened pretty quickly and pretty organically. But that, at least at the moment, is... And we're awesome. I don't know if
that helps.
I think there's a good note there of, like, when you're small and people don't know who you are yet, like, you can fail early, fail often as you learn.
Faster is, like, my biggest, like, mantra. Is like, just keep making things, keep iterating, keep doing it over and over again and figure out. It's important to figure out what works, but it's even more important to figure out what doesn't work for you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's great to figure that before people are noticing. So, So by the time that you actually do get noticed, then you're, like, already awesome. And you're like, oh, yeah, our stuff looks great.
It's like, they're so put together.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Ignore those five things that weren't any good. Exactly. Focus on the good thing. Yeah.
I think for us, it's a three brother studio as the founders. And I think, you know, we fought a lot growing up. So we kind of have, we got all of our, that sort of general rage angst out towards each other.
It goes away?
Yeah, it goes away after a time. Lots of broken noses and stuff. And nowadays, I think our biggest strength is actually essentially the way that we argue about things, because none of us care about our own position. The goal is essentially serving either the studio or the game. And so it's this sort of, it's this quest for what's best for that thing, and everybody's gonna have a different piece of input at the end of the day, but no one's championing their input. They're championing the idea that sort of feels like it's gonna make the most impact. And so because all of us are on that particular wavelength, then there's not any politics or any weird stuff going on. It's always just, you just argue about, okay, I think this is gonna be best. And someone's like, I think actually this would be best. And you're like, well, here's the outcome of those downstream, let's back it up, okay. And then you find a third point usually. And the thing we thought with bringing more people on was that we would sort of like have two camps that would evolve. But the reality is everyone is their own camp. So now we have seven points of view and you have to do this synthesis all the way up, which occasionally can get out of hand. So there's some points you gotta put a stop on it. But I think that is one of our biggest strengths, is actually that sort of argumentation style. It helps a lot for the creative work, and no one's scared to like give ideas and sort of argue about it.
Yeah, that is kind of the nice part about being an indie and working with people that you already know, mm-hmm. is you can kind of cut through like the corporate niceties,
yeah.
where you can just say what you really mean because you have this relationship with the person or with your partners. I think it's actually really helpful as well, but not everyone can duplicate that.
Right.
But yeah.
And for me, probably biggest strength is letting problems figure out their own solutions over a set period of time. So, I mean, I still need to get a game out the door, so I still need to have a goal in mind, but not rushing an individual decision at any point in time. At one point in the game, I was adding these powers for Last Ditch Goodnight, and so I've got these four different powers, and like there was kind of ties into elemental powers, and I kind of like that idea. So every time you used a power, whatever element it was associated with would like pop up over your hand, like over your fist. And like after playing that for about 2 months, I realized it was just distracting and terrible. And like by that point, the powers had nothing to do with elements. Why was I doing it? So I just killed it off right away, right? I had time to realize that was a terrible idea. And then probably like a year later, I realized there was something else I could do from like the four other characters in the world. I could have a little reference to them show up every time you use the power. And so it went from being this thing of like, oh, this is a terrible idea, I have to axe it, to being this thing like, oh no, this is good symbolism, that it adds a lot of weight to these characters and makes this important. When you're using these powers, it's not something you're doing frivolously, it's important. And just finding, you know, 2 years to figure that out made it all worthwhile. So I think taking the time to do it from that respect has been helpful for us.
Is there any significant disadvantage that you guys run into all the time, or like a hard lesson that you've experienced while you're going through that, like, you know, really was tough for you, but, you know, helped you inform your thinking and how you move forward afterwards?
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of ours comes down to marketing stuff, because we don't have any full-time marketing, and that is just a huge part of the industry. And there's a great, we went to GDC, the Games Developers Conference in San Francisco, and this guy broke out this great chart that was showing essentially earned revenue from games based on how well they were reviewed versus how well they were marketed. And it's always better to be more marketed than it is to have a better game. And we're good at making the games, but we're still sort of figuring out and trudging along awkwardly as far as figuring out the marketing scheme for stuff. Being such a small team and having to say like stop doing art to go do marketing, and not being able to just steep in that particular, you know, knowledge domain for a year or two to produce something incredible has been really, really hard.
Yeah, I would agree. Marketing is not my comfort zone, and it's something that I've had to learn, and I've spent a lot of time researching, and I'm still learning a lot because that tends to fall on me, being my position in the company. And yeah, like it's hard if that's not something you do every single day. Like, and to take the time to not, because it's something that honestly, like people generally kind of focus on making the game, and they're like, oh yeah, I guess I have to tell people about it. When really you need to be like marketing it, like not maybe when you're very first starting, but there comes a point where you have to start doing both, and figuring out when that line is and like how to do it effectively is definitely challenging when you're a small studio and you don't just have like one person who's dedicated to it.
I think I'm probably getting ready to do like my sixth trailer, and like I feel like I'm starting to not get how to make trailers, but how to get closer to making a trailer.
Like I'm learning.
Yes. So like, and every step, and like you said, yeah, if I could just focus on doing that for 6 months at a time, you know, I could probably make something amazing. But you know, having to jump from job to job to job makes it a little bit trickier. Mm-hmm. And then I think the other disadvantage is, you know, surrounding yourself with people that you can trust, you know, to give you good feedback, to give you good responses to what you're doing. But then also realizing at the end of the day, day, it's still on your shoulders to make it happen. So, you know, good people around you, but still follow through.
Well, and everyone's experience is very different given their circumstances. So you kind of have to ask for a lot of advice or talk to a lot of people, but then take everything that every person says with a hefty grain of salt and figure out how that works for your situation. Mm-hmm. Because it's like my situation is very different than Sam's situation, then it's very different than Ben's situation. Like, we're all different, so we're not all going to be able to do the exact same solution to a problem.
I mean, one of our biggest mistakes early on was following veterans of the industry's advice from like Gama Sutra and stuff. When we were, you know, two-man team with no cash and no marketing power, and we were listening to the people who have sort of rock star fame, and for some reason we were like, oh, we'll do what they do. It'll work. It's not equivalent, you know. There's a lot of context there that we were missing that we didn't realize at the time. So yeah, definitely.
I always feel that's a problem anytime you read, like the 10 best productivity measures of the most productive people in the world. And, like, you know, Pharrell's system might work really great, or Tom Ford might take 3 showers a day or whatever it is that makes it work for him, but I'm not that person, and it's not going to work for me. You have to really parse that stuff down and curate that kind of content.
They've got a lot of staff that take care of a lot of, like, real life things that people don't like to talk about.
Yeah, if somebody does your laundry for you, that's a whole chunk of your day that you saved and that I spend a lot of time doing. Right. Exactly. At what point do you start the marketing cycle? You know, so, I think a lot of people think, oh, I finished the game, now I start marketing, but I don't think that's true. So, like, where should you really kick in?
Yeah, so the easy breakdown that we saw as a really small studio was that the art kind of runs out at some point where, I mean, you could keep on polishing it forever, of course, but at some point, everything has an asset in place that you made. It's not just like red squares and stuff for enemies. And at that point, that's usually when we start, that's in the previous, in the past, it's where we've started sort of turning our eye toward, okay, how do we actually launch this thing? And for how fast we make games, that was for the first two games about like a 3.5 week head start before we wanted to launch it, which is not a lot of time to both come up with a marketing plan, get people to know about it, get out the keys, all sort of stuff. So that was kind of our process before. And with our most recent game, Crashlands, we started our marketing push early. We actually thought the game was going to be done like 6 months, so we thought that we were kind of on schedule in the same sort of way, but it turned out it took 2 years. So we just happened to be marketing for a year and a half, which worked out well. But even then, you know, a lot of our early marketing efforts, we didn't actually know what the game was yet because we were only 6 months in. And so we started marketing it as this like mobile sort of survival game. It turned into a cross-platform just kind of general action RPG with crafting in it. And the problem was that press would get an email from us and then go Google it, and they'd hit one of our dev blogs from a year ago that was talking about some system that doesn't exist anymore, and then they'd start pegging the game in certain ways. And so we're still kind of figuring out when the best time is. I think our current strategy is what we call vague hype, where we're not going to say anything. We're just going to put out pictures that look good because we have extra art on staff now. Mm-hmm. And so we're getting there. It looks like we're working on another game. It looks like about a month and a half or two, we'll be able to start doing the sort of the generally vague, you know, get people excited about the poster thing and don't tell them anything. So that's our current strategy.
New from Butterscotch Shenanigans, Redacted. Right. A game about Redacted.
Right. I mean, Behemoth does, they do game, they just number the games. Yeah. They're pit people. It was called Game 4 for like a year. And they would just put pictures up. And I think it's a good way to do it.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah, we're still kind of obviously figuring that out as well. I think because we're so small, we're kind of like, we're doing the line of, we don't want to share too much early artwork too soon because, again, your style is going to change. Already the stuff we put out, you know, almost a year ago now when we very first started is different than the stuff that we have now. Granted, it's not drastically different because Matt has a very particular art style, and this game, he'd actually designed it. Like, it's kind of a unique situation in that we have the entire game, like, basically done on paper, and that'll obviously change a little bit, but that is kind of nice to know, like, it's not going to change from, it's a classic RPG with, you know, it's like Final Fantasy VI meets snack cakes. So that thankfully is good, but yeah, we're still running into that problem of, like, how much do we share, like, what is too soon, what is not too soon, but also we're little, so honestly, we probably can't share enough. So that is our current strategy.
Yeah. And that's a tough line to walk, too, because you want people to still play your game and be surprised by things they find in the game. You don't want to just give everything away. So, yeah, finding just enough to show them, to get them interested in and get them excited about it, it's a tough task. For me, kind of the barometric of when you start advertising has been, like, when I can show it to a person and I feel like I don't have to explain everything to them for it to make sense. So, like, I definitely had some cases where I'd, you know, go to some of our local game developer meetups and I'd show people the games and I'd be like, oh, but that's going to get fixed and ignore that and I need to change that around. So like once I hit that line where I could just take a step back and let them, you know, kind of enjoy it for its own terms, that's when I knew, okay, this is when I need to start really pushing things hard.
We have like 2 minutes left. Do any of you guys out there in our enormous audience have questions for us? If you do, raise your hand, yell it loud. Yes, sir.
Does there get to a point where you bring on like a sales marketing staff, or do you always kind of do that for yourself as long as you can? What's kind of the process there?
I think that really depends on your funding, honestly.
Yeah, that's the point, when you have money.
When you're, exactly. We're currently like bootstrapping our shit. Like, we do have a small income from our first games, but we specifically did not push hard on marketing on those games because we just wanted to learn the process before we really like dive deep. So yeah, like really, if we could have, like, if we wanted to spend that money there, like we could, but honestly, it makes more sense for us to not. But yeah, so if you have the money, it's a good idea.
Yeah, I think our general order is, we're bootstrapped as well. And with our general order of sort of hiring has been essentially art and tools and game dev capacity. So we build a lot of tools. Two-sevenths of our team is actually tools developers that just build stuff to make everybody else's building faster. I think we probably actually won't hire a marketing-only person until maybe like a few people down the line. So maybe like once we're around 10 or so, because there's actually not enough, there's enough work to do sometimes, mm-hmm. all the time, for a person who does marketing, but not for the whole two-year development cycle of a game, yeah. until we have enough products out and stuff like that. So I think we're waiting a little bit on that.
I was going to say real quick to add to that, like the one thing that's also hard is that no one is going to be as passionate about your game as yourself. So even if you do bring in some people, they'll probably have some, you know, format that they'll say, and okay, here's how I do a press release. I'm just going to put your information into it and ship it out. But you know, when you do it yourself, it's got that extra heart. It's got that voice we talked about earlier.
Yeah.
And that's something that you just can't buy, unfortunately. And I wish you could. That would be awesome.
Yeah. We got like time for like a really quick question. Yeah. Just.
Yeah. So when developing a game, you guys all work on different platforms. Do you think ahead of time what it's going to be on? You think potentially it'll be on this? Do you focus on one platform or more than that? How does deciding where it goes? Because we primarily do consoles, but mobile and PC obviously it might be big too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's more users.
So yeah. The question is like, how do you decide ahead of time what console you're or what platform you're going to be on, and how does that inform your decision making?
For me, I think it was shaped a lot by, since I had done some 360 stuff, like I still had that console idea in mind while I was working on it, but I still wanted to do PC, so I had to add some hooks for that. But when I first started, probably the first 6 months of it, like in my head, it could be on Android, it could be on iPhone, like how is this going to pan out? But then, you know, at the year mark, I realized just the level of complexity for input that it had was just something a touchscreen couldn't do. So it was definitely on the table, and I didn't really remove that option until it was just no longer feasible.
Yeah, like our game, we are planning to release it on all three. So we kind of have to take an approach of where you generally do, depending on what build you're going for at the moment, like takes precedence, but we have to kind of think of it, all of them at the same time. And like, so this is for, how does this work with controller input, and then how is this going to work with touch input? And so that it's definitely, that's something we're dealing with now, actually.
Yeah, it can be really challenging to build a really good user experience with the three, especially the pane of glass is the hardest one on touch.
Yeah.
But I think the most important piece, if you're going to multiple platforms, is to make it feel like it was built for each platform.
Yeah.
And so the biggest thing, if you're going on PC, and I'll tell you this because we got skewered by PC when we launched on there, was you need a ton of settings. They need to be able to just drag dials, all the dials.
Just like dummy dials.
Just everything. Because you'll notice actually, if you watch a lot of streamers and YouTubers, when they first open a PC game, they just go into the settings menu. I do the same thing when I play games. For some reason, I don't know why. I don't know what I think is there, but I just go in there and then, you know, tweak some dials and go back in the game. And we didn't have a lot of that at launch, and everyone sort of thought that we had just sort of, you know, ported the game. Which we hadn't. Most of the experience had been redone for that market, but we didn't quite finish it, and I think that kind of skewered us in the end.
Yeah. And as a console gamer, I don't ever touch those settings at all.
Yeah, that's so funny. I never look at them.
We need to wrap up, so I want each of you guys to tell everybody where they can find you and your games online, or you know how they keep up with you.
Sure. So Butterscotch Shenanigans is, you can find it at bscotch.net, or just type in Butterscotch Shenanigans. We also have a Twitter that we basically don't use, but if you want to get news blasts from us on there, it's at bscotch shenani. And we have our own podcast as well called Coffee with Butterscotch, which comes out every single week, so you can just search for that wherever you find your podcast.
Yeah, you can find us at volcanobean.com, and we're on Twitter and Instagram, and I guess technically Facebook.
Everybody's technically on Facebook. I didn't even mention it anymore.
But yeah, so search for Volcano Bean, and we're pretty, we're there.
Yep, and I'm at wellbredrhino.com, and it's got links to all my stuff there.
And like I said at the top of this thing, Pixel Pop Festival is coming August 5th and 6th at the St. Louis University Bush Student Center. It's going to be a great environment for people that are both game playing enthusiasts that want to try out new games from indie developers, both digital device games and paper tabletop games as well. And if you're into developing, there's going to be a ton of great programming like this with awesome speakers and opportunities to learn a lot about the industry there. So and you can find out more about that at pixelpopfestival.com. Thank you guys so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, guys. No game, but they say welcome to the second level.